In this video, we will discuss the secondary structure of DNA. Let's start by reviewing what we know about the primary structure of DNA. We know that a DNA molecule is a linear polymer composed of four types of nucleotides, each containing one of the following nitrogenous bases: adenine, cytosine, thymine, and guanine. The sequence of these nucleotides defines the primary sequence of the polymer. Experimental data suggests that the linear chain of nucleotides folds into a secondary structure. This is based on a study where native DNA was gently extracted from cells to avoid any alteration to its structure. Three different types of observations led to the current model of the secondary structure of DNA: the physical properties of native DNA, the chemical composition of DNA, and DNA structural data. All these experimental results contradicted the idea that native DNA exists as a single chain. This led James Watson and Francis Crick to propose the model of the DNA double helix. To build this model, we must first understand the properties of native DNA. The observation that the density and viscosity of DNA with a known nucleotide composition are higher than expected likely suggests that the DNA is not a single polynucleotide chain, but rather has a more complex structure, such as a double-stranded helix. The observation that certain compounds can chemically modify free nucleotides in solution, but not those in native DNA, suggests that the secondary structure of DNA protects the nitrogenous bases. This protection is likely due to a secondary structure, where the nitrogenous bases are oriented inward, shielded by the sugar phosphate backbone, and by base pairing with complementary nucleotides. The observation that native DNA has a lower absorbance at 260 nanometers compared to the theoretical value based on its nucleotide composition is a classic indication of the hypochromic effect. This effect occurs because the nitrogenous bases in native DNA are stacked and involved in interactions, which reduces their ability to absorb UV light. Even before the specific structure of DNA was fully understood, these interactions were known to influence UV absorbance. This graph shows the change in absorbance at 260 nanometers as a function of the temperature. The absorbance will remain constant at ambient temperatures. This absorbance is lower than the theoretical value, which is calculated based on the composition of the native DNA. However, as the temperature increases, you see a rapid increase in the absorbance of the DNA above a certain threshold. This is an inflection point that's called the melting temperature, or TM. The TM is the temperature at which 50% of the DNA is still in its native conformation. This process is called DNA denaturation. Finally, the absorbance reaches a plateau that is equivalent to the theoretical value that was calculated based on the composition of the DNA. The DNA is denatured due to the increase in temperature. The molecular weight of the denatured DNA is approximately half that of the native DNA molecular weight. The change of absorbance when the temperature increases suggests that the secondary structure of DNA is temperature sensitive. Renaturation of the DNA is possible by very slowly decreasing the temperature. So, what does this tell us? This experiment tells us four things. First, native DNA consists of more than a single polynucleotide chain, based on the observed high density and viscosity of DNA. Second, the secondary structure of DNA protects nitrogenous bases from chemical modifications, based on compounds modifying free nucleotides but not those in native DNA. Third, native DNA is hypochromic, indicating a secondary structure that reduces the absorbance of nitrogenous bases, based on the lower than expected absorption at 260 nanometers. And fourth, DNA's secondary structure is temperature sensitive and denatures with increasing temperature, based on changes in absorbance when temperature rises. Now let's look at the nucleotide composition of DNA. In 1947, Erwin Chargaff analyzed the composition of DNA and showed that nucleotide composition will change from one species to the next, but across species, some elements remain constant. This is the basis of the rule of parity. This rule states that the molar ratio of total purines to total pyrimidines is very close to 1. In other words, A plus G equals T plus C. The ratio of adenine to thymine is close to 1. This is also true for the ratio of guanine to cytosine. Chargaff also coined the GC rule. This rule states that the percentage of G and C is constant within a species but variable between species. Some species have modified nucleotides, such as the replacement of cytosine with 5-methylcytosine or hydroxymethylcytosine, but the parity rule still applies. What does the biophysical and structural data suggest? Native DNA molecules exist as fibers with a constant 20 angstrom diameter, and native DNA appears to be rigid molecules. This is unexpected for a DNA molecule made of a single chain of nucleotides. In this case, the presence of 5 covalent bonds that are capable of free rotation would be highly flexible. Therefore, native DNA must be constrained into a specific structure that confers its rigidity. In 1950, Rosalind Franklin and Maurice Wilkins subjected DNA fibers extracted from calf thymus to X-ray crystallography. When exposed to X-rays, the atoms in the DNA fiber diffracted electrons. They recorded this diffraction. Here we can see the original diffraction pattern that Franklin and Wilkins measured. This image shows a clear cross pattern, which suggests that DNA has a helical structure. Layers 1, 2, 3, and 5 reveal a periodicity of 34 angstroms, or 3.4 nanometers. The missing layer number 4 indicates that the molecule contains 2 helical strands with a slight offset. A higher resolution revealed a second diffraction pattern with a second periodicity of 3.4 angstroms. All this information led Watson and Crick to propose a model that describes the secondary structure of DNA. The known properties of native DNA and its composition support this model. DNA consists of 2 separate strands that form a double helix with a fixed 20 angstrom diameter. The 2 strands are antiparallel. This means that one will run from top to bottom, 3 prime to 5 prime, and the other will run from top to bottom, 5 prime to 3 prime, and form a right-handed helix. The sugar phosphate backbone of each strand forms the outer part of the double helix. The nitrogenous bases on both strands lie perpendicular to the axis of the helix and are oriented toward each other in the center of the double helix. The secondary structure is stabilized by interstrand hydrogen bonds between nucleotide bases to form base pairs. The pairing of nucleotide bases between the 2 strands is due to hydrogen bonds between A and T, or G and C. The distance between 2 adjacent stacks of base pairs is 3.4 angstroms. The pitch of the double helix is 34 angstroms, which indicates that each turn of the double helix contains close to 10 base pairs. Now that we know the DNA double helix has a constant diameter, let's look at a simplified representation. What we have here are our 2 strands. Each strand has a sugar phosphate backbone and, between them, base pairs. We can see that there are 3 hydrogen bonds between C and G, and only 2 between T and A. Van der Waals interactions are present between base pair stacks such as T and C here. All of these forces stabilize the secondary structure of DNA. We can see here that for both TA and CG pairs, the alignment is optimum. This results in the maximized hydrogen bond strength. Let's think about what would happen if a T tried to pair with a G or with a C. We can look at only the T and C here by eliminating the bases on the second strand. The red arrows represent the perfect direction required to form highly stable hydrogen bonds. Now we can look at the strand that contains only a G and a T. The blue arrows here represent the direction of hydrogen bonding required for a highly stable structure. We can see that the red and blue arrows do not line up here. This means that to create hydrogen bonds between T and G, or C and T, we would have to distort the secondary structure of the DNA strand and cause changes in the diameter of the double helix. But we know that the diameter of the double helix is constant. The stacking of bases would also be affected and the double helix would be unstable. This suggested that Watson and Crick's hypothesis for the secondary structure of DNA was correct. The B form of the DNA double helix was used to create the double helix model. B DNA fibers have high water content and a diameter of 20 angstroms. There are approximately 10 base pairs per turn of a double helix. The helical pitch is 34 angstroms, and the axis of the double helix passes through the base pairs. Now let's look at a top view of this helix. We can see that the way the base pairs attach to the sugar phosphate backbone causes them to emerge at an angle of 120 degrees. If we remember that these base pairs are stacked on top of each other, these 240 and 120 degree angles will cause two grooves to be formed along the double helix. One is the minor groove at 12 angstroms wide, and the other is the major groove at 22 angstroms wide. These grooves, in particular the major groove, allow sequence-specific binding of proteins to DNA. Now that we're familiar with the B form of DNA, let's look at the A form. The A form of DNA is another type of double helix. A-DNA has a lower water content than B-DNA. By comparing the two types of DNA, we can see that A-DNA is shorter and wider. The diameter of the helix is 23 angstroms compared to the 20 angstroms of B-DNA. There are roughly 11 base pairs per turn of the A-DNA double helix compared to 10 in B-DNA. The helical pitch is 28.2 angstroms compared to 34 angstroms in BDNA. The axis of the double helix passes through the major groove and not through the base pairs, as in BDNA. ADNA gives a higher quality diffraction pattern than BDNA fibers, and so when the diffraction pattern of BDNA was initially studied, it was difficult to determine whether the DNA molecule had two or three strands. The study of ADNA confirmed that only two strands were present. The interconversion between A and B DNA also confirmed that both only have two strands. Interconversion can happen by just changing the water content of the DNA molecules. The B DNA conformation is the average and ideal structure of most cellular DNA. The A DNA conformation is found when DNA associates with some proteins and is common in double-stranded regions of RNA. Let's summarize what we've learned about the secondary structure of DNA. Nucleic acids, including DNA and RNA, are polymers of nucleotides. The secondary structure of DNA is understood through a combination of its chemical, biophysical, and structural properties, alongside the parity rule, which dictates base pairing. The double helix model reflects the intricate interplay of these fundamental characteristics. A major consequence of the secondary structure of DNA is the relative base pairing constraints. The two strands are complementary, and this constraint does not affect the diversity of the DNA sequence because diversity is based on adjacent bases on the same strand. The fact that strands are complementary and antiparallel has two major functional consequences. It provides a simple, semi-conservative basis for copying genetic information during DNA replication, and it enables a simple template-based mechanism for generating information-bearing transcripts during transcription. Complementarity and base pairing between two DNA strands, or DNA hybridization, is at the foundation of most methods in molecular biology. These include screening libraries to identify genes, determining the primary sequence of a DNA molecule, cloning DNA fragments into vectors, amplifying DNA by polymerase chain reaction, and gene editing using the CRISPR system.